पे ट्रैवल करोगे? Let's give another minute and we are good to start. Hi, good evening all. A warm welcome to all of you. For those who don't know me, my name is Vrishab. I head the compliance business for Allsec Technologies. I'm based out of Bangalore, and it's been almost 4 years with Allsec now. Just to give a quick brief about Allsec, Allsec today is India's leading payroll compliance provider. We process multi-country payroll, and under the compliance umbrella, we are a pan-India service provider. This session is jointly hosted by our technology partner, Simpliance. Simpliance also has been in this market for almost 4 years right now, and they are have done some substantial work under the compliance management tool. Both Allsec and Simpliance belong to a much larger family called Questcorp. And Questcorp today is India's leading business services company and the largest private sector employer today. Firstly, I want to thank the marketing folks, Uthiya and Prithika, and their team for arranging this session. And most importantly, choosing the app name, Decoding Labor Laws. Yes, we all have been hearing this for almost quite some time now, and I'm sure that we all are here to decode these four codes. You might have heard all economists have been actually arguing India's outdated labor laws. I generally call it quite archaic, the kind of amount of years I've spent in this compliance business right now. We have been hearing about these reforms for quite some time. In fact, in the last 2-3 years, if you actually look at some of these states have done some minor reforms. And at the current context, the ease of doing business is the jig word, right? And getting India back on track, what typically the media folks call. I think these quotes are well timed, and I have been attending quite of these sessions, specifically hosted by various industry sectors. It's good to learn. On a personal note, I see them really progressive. Okay, I'm sure many of you have already attended similar sessions which in the market, and or at least read the communication through various channels. Our agenda today is very specific. We wanted to just make it to the core, be specific, and stick to what exactly is in the law. So Honestly, we have timed this for an hour, but getting all the four codes spoken is really a tough time. But we plan to host more of these sessions and get into more of detailing. But before we quickly start, I would like to introduce these speakers. I have with me Mr. Uday Kumar. Uday Kumar currently heads the legal and consulting division. He has almost 15 years of experience and he has spent a great amount of time under the labor matters. He not only brings domain knowledge, but actually real time experiences. Thanks, Uday, for joining and welcome.
Thanks, Rishabh.
Next, we have Anuk. Many of the audiences are all ALSEC clients. And if any of you have raised a query, a labor law query, it's Anuk actually at the back end who manages these and responds to them in detail. He's generally called the backbone of the operations. He's a postgraduate in law and he always brings new perspectives to the legal scenarios. Welcome, Anuk, and thanks for joining in. We also have Anime Singh. Anime is a first generation lawyer and has completed his graduation in the Christ University and law. Yeah, he's part of the Simplance legal team, currently the most wanted man, I would rather call, and has been instrumental in working on this code, stacking them and ensuring the Simplance tool is abreast with the most recent changes. So this is about the speakers. We'll have a quick Q&A session at the, we have planned it at the end of the session when we finish each of these codes, and I urge each one of you to raise questions. I already see some questions in the pipeline. We have a moderator parallel to me who is going to publish some of those. What we have done is we have not rated these codes at present in terms of the severity or the complexity. Personally, I feel the code of wages is going to be quite interesting. So I think let's start with the code on wages. Anime, over to you.
Thank you, Rishabh. So moving on, we come to our code on wages. So we move to the next slide, please. So I'm sure everybody here knows that these are the four main codes that we're going to be discussing today. So moving on to our code on wages slide, please. So yeah, our code on wages subsumes four major central acts, right? It those being the Minimum Wages Act, your Payment of Wage Act, your Payment of Bonus Act, and the Equal Remuneration Act. The objective of the act is to provide a streamlined basis for the payment of wages in India and sort of doing away with the regulatory confusion that existed prior to the in the incoming of the code. Moving on to the next slide. Further on, we can move on. Yeah. So a lot of questions come in from various clients from various sectors, relating to what is the current status of the code on wages. Now, this answer has to come with a little bit of a legal backdrop, right? So when a law is passed by Parliament, it can come into force into two ways. So either the law says in itself that at the moment Parliament passes this law, it comes into force, or the law comes into force with something called an enabling provision. Now, with regards to the code on wages, the latter is the case, right? So the code on wages is technically a law. If you refer to the third point, you'll see that the code on wages is technically a law, but it has not been brought into effect yet, meaning that for the code to come into effect, a notification has to be issued by the central government in the official gazette. So this is what the enabling provision under section 1 clause 3 of the code, that is what it mandates, right? Moving on. So the key feature, according to me, from an impact point of view, from the code on wages, is the universal definition of wages across the codes. Now, what does universal definition mean? This is a big change brought in by the government to sort of remove some of the regulatory confusion. Prior to the codes, what we had was different definition of wages under different acts, meaning your PF, your ESI, your gratuity, your bonus act. Each act had its own definition of wages. what the government has now done is that it's taken a single definition of wages and applied it across all the four codes. That is what universal definition refers to. Now, if you refer to point two, you'll understand that the new universal definition of wages has three major components. The first two being your inclusive aspects and excluded allowances. So the inclusive aspects of this universal definition are your basic DNS allowance and your retaining allowance. So these are considered parts of your wages. Now, excluded allowances are not considered part of wages. So what comes under excluded allowances? Excluded allowances include HRA, include travel conveyance allowance, include a list of components from A to K under the definition clause, under section 2Y of the Code on Wages. Now, the third part, which is the most interesting part of this universal definition of wages, is the proviso. The proviso essentially says that the amount of excluded allowances, if you refer to the third part of the slide, the amount of excluded allowances exceeding 50% of total remuneration shall be deemed wages and added to the same. Now, we will examine the effect of this universal definition. So moving on. Right. So the proviso's effect, like I said, you have your inclusive aspects, your excluded allowances and your proviso. Now, if you look at basic DA in the first part of the table, you see that basic plus DA, which is 10,000 plus 8,000 rupees, forms 18,000, which is the inclusive aspect of the definition, with conveyance and HRA forming 19,000. So you now, prima facie, it is quite clear that the sum of excluded allowances is greater than the sum of inclusive aspects. However, what the definition says is that the quantum of excluded allowance has to be more than 50% of the total wage. So we don't take the excluded allowances here. What we do is we add the inclusive and excluded allowances to find out the total wage, which is 37,000 rupees. And 50% of that would be 18,500. Then what we do is we find the difference between the excluded allowances and that 50% amount, meaning the difference between 19,000 and 18,500 to conclude that the deemed wages under the proviso would be 500 rupees. So the intention behind bringing about this proviso is to ensure that employers pay majority or at least 50% of wages to their employees in the form of their inclusive components, namely basic HRA, DNS allowance and retaining allowance. So the objective is to ensure that employees are paid in this manner. Now, who is this going to impact? This is going to impact people who earn large sums of their salary from the excluded allowances. So let's take, for example, sales employees. Sales employees tend to earn a large part of their income from commission-based payments, which is one of the excluded allowances under the definition of wages. So what will now happen is the large chunk of payment falling under the excluded allowances will start being added to their wages through the proviso's effect. So sales employees would be one example where this definition would impact. Second place where this definition would have an impact would be executives. So people employed in executive positions, those who are in earning large amounts of their income from bonuses or year-end bonuses, etc. If their compensation comes in that form, then the proviso will keep adding only a certain amount of that to their wages. So that is the illustration of the proviso's effect. Moving on. Now, coming back to wrap up this whole section on the universal definition of wages. So like I said earlier, there was a lot of confusion due to disparity in definitions across different acts. Now that this disparity has been done away with, we have to understand what effect this uniform definition of wages has on each statutory benefit. So the EPF, or looking at your Provident Fund contribution. So when we come down to actually analyzing the impact of this uniform definition of wages on your Provident Fund contribution, you see that the scheme is largely similar, because basic wages under the EPF Act, read with Section 6, provides that basic and DA are both parts of your wages for basic wages. So by and large, the impact on the EPF contributions will not be significant, but it is important to bear in mind the impact of the proviso, because when you have people earning large sums of money through commission-based payments, what will happen is that will create a snowball effect. And because that amount keeps getting added to their wages, their EPF contributions will also keep increasing. Therefore, employers should be wary of this this effect. Now, coming to our employee state insurance, ESI contributions. So when we compare the two definitions of wages under the code versus wages under the ESI Act, what we find is that the wage definition under the code does not include the clause that says additional remuneration being paid at intervals not exceeding 2 months. So what does this mean? Earlier medical allowances, different allowances that were being paid at this interval were included in wages for the purpose of ESIC. Now the same has been done away with, because all of that has come under excluded allowances. Therefore, it is likely that this would result in reduction of your ESI contribution. Moving on. Your gratuity. Now, once again, when we juxtapose the definitions of wages under the Gratuity Act and the Code on Wages, what we see is that the exclusions are very, very similar between both the definitions. So that might prompt you to ask then, is there no impact on gratuity, or would there be no change? Now here, once again, we have to keep in mind the proviso, because gratuity is always calculated on last drawn wages. Now what would happen is, if suppose somebody is earning a large bonus or a large commission on their last month payment, last month of employment, this would lead to their wages being inflated for gratuity calculation. So a recommendation would be to consider average wage. So this is something that we at Simpliance have submitted to the government as well, and are hoping it gets implemented. Now coming to bonus, right? So earlier, it was a very common practice under the Payment of Bonus Act, due to the 21,000 rupee threshold, for employers to add all emoluments to wages and thus bring it above the threshold and be exempt from paying the same. Now what has happened is this cannot be done at such a level because of the proviso. As soon as you inflate the emoluments, the same will start being added to your wages due to the proviso's effect. Now moving on. So this is just a comparative analysis of compliance under the code. So it is quite clear from the same, where you can see before, where we had four registers under four different acts and had four returns. What the government has done is streamlined all of this and simplified compliance for everybody. However, that being said, I would prompt everybody attending this session to take a look at the penalty charges as well. The government has not simplified compliance only for the sake of making business easier. It is also looking at hefty penalties for violation. So bear in mind that the ease of compliance does also come with a cost for non-compliance. Moving on. Just to summarize then, from our code on wages, what would be the key takeaways? First would be your change in wage structure. So if you refer to the fourth point on the slide, you would see that because the segregation of excluded allowances has happened, there would be a large shift in a lot of organizations, because they would have to change the way wages are paid to certain employees, especially sales employees and executives, right? Now returns, as I mentioned earlier, you have single returns with multiple components for all states and registered. So this is a very important point to note here. Provided that all states adopt the central rules in their entirety, the best case scenario right now would be that two registers would be have to submit it, as opposed to 253, which is currently the status quo. Now the other features include inspector cum facilitator, which will be made clearer under the OSH Act. Moving on. Under this slide, what would be your key takeaway is under minimum wages. So if you see rule 3, 4 and 11, you would see that firstly, the manner of calculating minimum wages has been brought into line with the criteria fixed under the Apex Court's judgment in Repticos Brett. Secondly, rule 5, or rule 4 rather, mentions that minimum wages are now going to be specified by the central government into three areas, those being metropolitan areas, non-metropolitan areas and rural areas. And lastly, which is the most significant change in the minimum wages framework, would be your introduction of national floor wage. What this ensures is that state governments cannot pay a minimum wage lower than the national floor wage, ensuring that minimum wages across the country are at least above a certain threshold so that there are not large fluctuations between states, leading to ease of compliance across India, especially for establishments that have pan-India coverage. Moving on. The last slide would just shed some light on the responsibility of a principal employer to pay the contractor for timely payment of wages to contract workers, the payment of bonus, and the categorization of employees. So these are largely small features that have been retained from earlier legislation and would therefore be implemented in a similar manner. So now I would like to hand over to Mr. Anuk, who will be covering the code on social security. Anuk, over to you.
Anuk, please unmute yourself.
Good evening, one and all. I'll be discussing on the code on social security. Of the four codes, this being one among it. And as my predecessor speaker started off saying that the 44 labor legislations have been codified. Technically, if you look at the four codes, there are 29 central legislations which would be subsumed into these four codes. And the code on social security would subsume 9 legislations, which I would be discussing in my next slide. As with all the four codes, this social security code also has passed through the parliament, has received the presidential assent, has been published in the Gazette. Now it is to be operationalized through the rules, the schemes which have to be framed thereunder. And once that is there, the code on social security would be good to go ahead. Let's pass on to the next slide. The code on social security, as I stated, would subsume 9 primary legislations into it. Of that, the employee provident fund, employee state insurance, employee compensation, maternity benefit act, payment of gratuity act, and employee compensation act being most predominant ones. While the code on social security has replicated most of the provisions which are there in the existing legislations, but there are some changes, the finer details, and also there have been new concepts which have been brought about, which I will be discussing in the further slides. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Yeah, so first let's discuss on ESI. The code on social security has around 164 sections spread across 14 chapters, and it has 7 schedules. Chapter 4 deals with the ESI. While, as I've already stated, for ESI and EPF, majority of the provisions have been retained in its present form, but I would focus on where the changes exactly would lie. Presently, the ESI Act applies in the notified areas under the ESI, as and when they set up their dispensaries or hospitals or when they have their infrastructure ready, they cover those areas, and the employers having establishment in such coverable areas have to make contributions to the ESIC. But whereas under the Social Security Code, Code on Social Security would have pan-India coverage across all 740 districts in India. And the threshold limit remains the same, that is 10 or more employees for the applicability of ESI. Whereas until recently, state in Maharashtra or Chandigarh, where the threshold was 20 or more, there's a uniform threshold of 10 or more in terms of applicability of ESI chapter under the Social Security Code. And further, establishments which are into hazardous activities, irrespective of the number of employees, even if they employ one employee, then they would be covered under the ESI Act. And while voluntary registration was available under EPF before, ESI Act mandatorily had to have 10 or more employees in your establishment to get it covered. But whereas there has been a provision for voluntary coverage also under ESI now, that is something new. And another important aspect of what I would like to bring about is that prior, in the present scheme of things, if employer has defaulted in terms of ESI contribution on behalf of their employees, then in terms of getting benefits from ESIC is a challenge for the beneficiaries. But whereas under the Social Security Code, the employee can be still given the benefits from the ESIC, but the cost of it would be recovered from the employers. So all the more important for the employers to take note of this, because apart from the penalty, interest and damages, they can also impose the cost of the benefit given to the employee if they have defaulted. Now moving on to EPFO, the Employee Provident Fund. Can you go back to the previous slide, please? Yeah. So Chapter 3 of the Social Security Code would deal with the Employee Provident Fund. Presently, the EPF Act has three schemes in it, the Provident Fund, the Pension Scheme, and the Insurance Scheme. These have been retained under the legislation. So there would be similar schemes which would be framed under the Social Security rules, which would come up later. And in terms of applicability, they have again retained the same. It is 20 or more employees, all establishments with 20 or more workers have to register with the EPF. And central government by notification would notify the rates of contribution. While Section 16 states that the rate of contributions would be at 10%, but there is provision for it to be notified at 12%, as is the case with the EPF Act. Another important aspect which I would like to bring about here is that there is chance for differential contribution which may be prescribed by EPFO. That is, the employee contribution can remain at 10, whereas the employer contribution would be at 12%, probably with the intention of increasing the take-home salary of the employee. But this is through a separate notification which they have to do. What is new to EPF is that under the present legislation, there is no limitation with respect to determination of any contribution or dues. So the inspectors can walk in and with impunity, they can ask for records beyond, say, for 10 years, 12 years or 7 years. But under the EPA, the Social Security Code, there has been a limitation prescribed, which is been set at 5 years. And also the present 7A proceedings, which used to happen before the RPFC or the authorities before the under EPF, that they have been given a timeline of just 2 years in order to complete the inquiry. And if there is an adverse order passed against any employer, and if they wish to seek an appeal against this order which has been passed by EPFO, then you have to deposit 25% of the determined amount in order to seek an appeal to the tribunal, and the tribunal would have to dispose of the case within 1 year. Can we move on to the next slide, please? Yeah, so another new aspect which we can talk about, social security for the unorganized workers. While the organized sector is where there is traditional employer-employee relationship, that is, there is appointment letter, where there are establishments covered under EPF, ESI, where they're extended all these benefits. There are set of workers like gig workers, platform workers, unorganized workers, etc., who are out of the social security ambit. So in order to bring them on board with social security, the Social Security Code proposes a government to form social security schemes for these workers. These schemes would be financed through contribution from the employer in case of gig and platform workers, the gig workers themselves and the appropriate government. Gig worker is someone who is defined as someone who is out of the traditional employer-employee relationship. As I said, a traditional employer-employee relationship would involve issuing of appointment order, the establishment would be covered under EPFO ESI, the employer would have the direct control over such employees. But whereas a gig worker, what your Ola drivers, Uber, Dunzo, and all of these, they would be considered gig workers, and more precisely, they would be considered as platform workers if they are using online platforms of Ola, Uber, or Urban Cab, such companies, in order to render their services. And these aggregators, as of now, who claim immunity from EPF, ESI for these such service providers staking claim that they're not their employees, but now they would not be considered their employees, but would be regarded as platform workers. And these aggregators per se, they would have to shell out some part of their turnover, which would be up from 1 to 2% towards the social security schemes of the gig workers or platform workers. And this scheme would be applicable only for gig and platform workers, not for the regular employees. Can we move on to the next slide? While regarding the building and other construction workers, while there is a, under the present scheme of things, there is the Building and Other Constructions Act, which would be dealt under the OSH code. While there is a sister act to this called the Building and Other Construction Workers Cess Act, where on the cost of construction, the government used to levy a cess on the cost of construction, and that had to be paid up by the employer. That would be subsumed, the Cess Act would be subsumed under the Social Security Code. Earlier, the building and other construction worker, it excluded residential purpose constructions for which the value of was below 10 lakhs. Now this has been increased to 50 lakhs. And further, before the, in the present scheme of things, the fact is that you have to submit all your records to the concerned authority who would assess the amount of cess, and that would be imposed upon you, which you are supposed to pay. Whereas under the Social Security Code, they have given the provision of self-assessment based on your records. And the BOCW cess, as is the case now, is set between 1 to 2% of the cost of the construction. And the BOCW workers, the employer has to register them as beneficiaries with the respective state BOCW board. Coming to the registration of establishment under the SS code, while there is a provision for electronically registering new establishments under the code, but establishments which are already registered under any of the central legislation, either ESI, PF, they need not seek registration again under the Social Security Code. And with the present scheme of things where PF or ESI, there is no specific provision for cancellation of registration. Rather, you have to surrender it through a cumbersome process. Whereas under the Social Security Code, they have also given the procedure for cancel of registration when the company is being wounded up or the company is being shut down. Next slide, please. Employment information and monitoring. In the present scheme of things, as I've said, the Employment Exchange Act is what is governing this aspect, where you the employers file a quarterly return, a biennial return, notice of opening, and etc. But that has been rechristened into something known as career centers, which probably we may expect it to be a website, just like the National Career Portal, where employers with 20, where establishment with 20 or more employees would mandatorily have to send the vacancies in terms of which is occurring in their organization to this career center. Probably this would be done by the central government, and the entire aspect would be going online. So there would be no offline submission of any vacancies. It would be complete online procedure. Other few aspects which I would like to talk about Social Security Code is that presently the PF Act and ESI Act, there's always been confusion on the applicability for especially small organizations, with the fact that whether the employee threshold 10 or 20, whether we need to consider all the employees or is it only the coverable employees. With respect to the Social Security Code, this has been done away with through an explanation to the employee definition. It states that all employees, irrespective of their wages, have to be considered in terms of the threshold. So there's a much needed clarity there. And in terms of gratuity, most of the provisions remain the same, except for the fixed term employee. They would be paid gratuity on pro rata basis, and they need not complete 5 years of continuous employment under an employer. Mind you, this is only for fixed term employees and not your regular or any other kind of employees. And in the present scheme of things, the enforcing authorities are called inspectors, while under all the four codes, they would be rechristened into inspectors cum facilitators, where they would not only enforce the act, but would also help the employers in order to comply. Maternity benefit, provisions are largely same, except the fact that there is provision for common crèche facility, which can be maintained by a group of employers. Especially IT, ITS companies who are in a cluster, say in SEZ or IT Tech Park, this was a welcome move for them. And compounding of offenses, apart from the levying penalty and prosecution, if the employer wishes to plead guilty, they may pay a fine of the 50% of what is prescribed, and they may compound the offenses and the charges would be dropped. And as my predecessor speaker told, with all this ease of doing business and certain benefits being rolled out to the employers, but penalties have been increased manifold, which you need to be wary about. With that, I would complete the presentation on the Social Security Code. Over to Udaya sir to take up the next code.
Sir, you need to unmute yourself.
Hi everyone. Today I would be speaking about Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code. Like other codes, OSH code also has been notified and draft rules have also been come. And it is yet to get implemented by the way of notification in the Official Gazette. Moving on to the next slide. So as all of you know, this code also subsumes other 13 legislations, erstwhile legislations, which are Factories Act, Plantation Act, Mines Act, Working Journalist and Newspaper Employees Act, your Working Journalist Fixation of Wages Act, Motor Transport Vehicles Act, BD and Cigar Workers Act, Contract Labor Act, Sales Promotion Employees Conditions Act, Condition of Service Act, Interstate Migrant Workmen Conditions of Service Act, and Cine Workers and Cinema Theatre Workers Act, Dock Workers Act, and Building and Other Construction Workers Service Regulation of Employment Conditions and Conditions of Service Act. So not the as my predecessor speaker Anuk spoke. He spoke about the CESS Act, and the act which covers here is the BOCW Service Conditions Act here. And moving on to the next slide. Next slide, please. So where does it apply? So to which all establishments it applies? It applies to all the establishments having 10 or more workers, and registration is mandatory for all the workers having 10 or more establishments having 10 or more workers. And for factories, for the applicability of the provisions of this code, except for registration, the threshold has been fixed as 20 in case of factory with power and 40 in case of factory without the aid of power. And the draft rules for OSH code has come by 19th November 2020. Move on to the next slide, please. Yeah, so by this OSH code coming into place, what and all changes now, and what needs to, as an employer, what and all we need to look at. So now what happened is post effectiveness of this OSH code, which we expect around somewhere in April 1st next year, 2021. Appointment letter, issuance of appointment letter by the employer has been made mandatory for all employees. So this is one of the requirement which every employer, even for contract workers or casual workers or any daily workers also need to be given a appointment letter henceforth, which was not the case earlier. Then comes the annual health checkups. Annual health checkups have been made mandatory for certain sect of employees or workers in certain establishments which may be notified. And as from the draft rules, what we see is it has been made mandatory for workers who are above 45 years and above for a notified establishments. Then employing women in all types of work in night shifts. Earlier there was a lot of restrictions for employing women workers. Now women workers can be made work in night shifts, and they have also classified the timeline to it again, which is 7 p.m. to 6 a.m. and their here we need to have a consent mandatorily from the women workers while doing or engaging women employees in the night shifts. And all the safety and security aspects which were earlier adapted or followed has to be followed, or it might even get little stricter. Then comes an option of common license. So common license is one option which is a welcome move, and again appreciated by the employers. Now this getting implemented, a contractor can have one single all India license for a period of 5 years to engage the contract laborers. So one license under OSH can be taken for license for factories or contract labor, BD or cigar establishments. And this concept is a very welcome move. Then moving on, a safety committee. So safety committee is again has to be constituted for workers here. Again, constitution of safety committee by appropriate government in any establishment or class of establishments may be notified. The committees will be composed of representatives of employer and workers and shall function as a liaison body between them. The number of representatives of workers in the committee must not be less than that of the employer. That means there should be an equal representation by the employer as well as the employees. Again, next is the interstate migrant workers. So the OSH code has expanded the definition of migrant workers, that the migrant workers moving from one state to another state even on their own, and migrant workers who have been appointed by the employer from a different state and their salary and in salary less than 18,000 have been brought under the ambit of the code. That means anyone who is drawing above 18,000 may not fall under the salary of 18,000 may not fall under the definition of interstate migrant worker. But any person who is also traveled, earlier the situation was that only if an employer goes and engages or makes an worker to come on with an appointment letter to a different state and make him work for in a different location, you used to come under the coverage of interstate migrant worker. Now the case is different, where even a worker who has come at his own will fall under the definition of interstate migrant worker, subject to their salary is lesser than 18,000. And for them, you have to also have a travel allowance, which has to be paid on an annual basis once a year by the employer to visit their hometown. This is one additional compliance which an employer needs to take care of. Again, a database and helpline provision have been made for creation of maintenance of database on migrant workers to help in targeting, skill mapping and utilization of government schemes by the worker. So this database and other things are supposed to be maintained by the government. But of course, yes, this details and inputs will be again taken from the employers for each and every filing. So that might be one of a requirement. Again, a helpline shall be set up to address and resolve the issues faced by migrant workers when they have any what we recently encountered or seen in a pandemic situation. Then comes the working hours. Now they have made under OSH code, they have made that no worker will be required or allowed to work in any establishment for more than 8 hours in a day. Having said that, there are different work hours which has been defined in our shops and establishment registration. So that we need to see whether that is going to supersede, or there might be a respective amendments to respective shops and establishment act or any other work condition act which is going to have a state applicability. Again, in case of overtime of work, workers must not be paid lesser than twice the rate of wages has been very clearly brought under the workers in OSH code. Women can work past 7 p.m. and 6 a.m. subject to any regulations again prescribed by the government. So these are the aspects around workers. Moving on to leaves, a worker cannot be required to work for more than 6 days in 1 week. That means a week, it is usually there in all our service conditions legislations like Shops and Establishment Act or Motor Vehicles Act also. No person can be asked to work beyond 6 days in a week, and 1 day of mandatory off has to be given. Annual leave with wages must be provided to every worker subject to certain conditions which has been prescribed under the OSH code. So the worker has to work for 180 days or more in a calendar year kind of conditions have been fixed. Moving on to working conditions, again, the central government shall notify the working conditions which may include provisions relating to hygienic work environment or clean drinking water or toilets, ventilation, adequate space, lightings, etc. This being a concurrent legislation, central legislation as well as the state government will have its own notification or rules framed around these working conditions. Moving on to welfare facilities such as canteens, first aid box, creches may be provided for by way of notification by the central government. Creches, they have already suggested to have 50 or more employees, and for canteens they have said 100 or more workers. So these have been already prescribed here, and additional facilities may be again notified or specified by the state government or central government with respect to factories, mines and docks or building and other construction workers depending on the states. Advisory boards on central level, a national occupational safety and health advisory board shall be constituted to give recommendations to central government. In a similar pattern, state government also will have an advisory board which will give advices to the state government to implement such matters arising out of the administration of OSH code. So there may be two advisory board which will act in respect of OSH code. Again, employee compensation, if a worker dies or is injured due to workplace accident, his workplace at least 50% share of the penalty can be given to him by way of a order of the court. The amount would in addition to his regular employee compensation. This is one additional provision which has been brought under the employee compensation under OSH code. Again, in case of fatal accidents, the employer contractor is required to report the same to the authorities and to the dependents of the deceased. Benefits are also required to be extended as per the new norms which has been formulated under the Employee Compensation Act, where in case of non-compliances, the result in death or bodily injury, the court may direct 50% of fine to be given directly to the deceased dependents or legal heirs of the deceased. Moving on to the concept of contract workers. So what is a contract worker concept now under OSH code states is core activities, prohibition of core activities which were there earlier again has been clarified further in OSH code. So there is a prohibition, clear prohibition of the employment of contract labors in core activities, except or subject to certain conditions. The normal functioning of the establishment in such that the activity is ordinarily done through a contractor, there it may continue. The activities are such that they do not require full-time workers. There are a lot of factories or working manufacturing units which does not require, for example, seasonal units which may not require regular workers or permanent employees, there contract workers engagement at full time can be done. So these are similar to what was there in the earlier conditions. What further clarifies here is the definition of core activities have been very explicitly brought under the OSH code, where they have said that sanitation work, watch and ward services, including security services, canteen or catering services, loading or unloading operations, running hospital education institutions, courier services, civil and other construction workers, gardening, maintenance, all this kind of housekeeping, transport services, all these things are non-core activities where there can be an engagement of contract workers. Moving on to schedule under the codes. The code contains three.
We have, sorry to interrupt. We have limited time, so if we can move fast, we have, I will have a quick last code to cover as well.
Yeah, so a couple of minutes more. So the schedule under the codes, the code has three schedules containing list of 29 diseases, 73 safety matters, again 40 industries involving hazardous process. All this has been very explicitly brought under the schedule of this code. Again, duty of employees have also been very explicitly drafted out, which states providing a workplace that is free from all hazardous works, and providing free annual health checkups for notified establishments, informing relevant authorities in case of accidents. Again, additional duties, additional duties have been prescribed for employers in factories, mines and docks and BOCW. So these are the additional responsibilities vested upon an employer when it comes to the occupational safety and health workers. That's from my side. Moving on to IR code, over to you, Animai.
Thank you, sir. Moving on. Can you move on to the next slide, please? So the status with regards to the IR code remains largely same to the other codes. The draft rules have been published for public objections, and those shall be done within a period of 45 days. So can we move on to the next slide, please? I'm sure everyone here is aware that the Industrial Relations Code takes in three major central acts, those being the ID Act, the Trade Unions Act, and the Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act. Can we move on to the next slide, please? So this is a key change brought in by the Industrial Relations Code, in which it has incorporated the definition of industry as per the Supreme Court's judgment in Bangalore Water Supply versus R. Rajappa. This is basically a seven judge, so a constitutional bench of the Supreme Court, expanded upon the scope of industry, which was a bone of contention between a lot of people, because there was a lot of doubt over whether my establishment came under the scope of industry or not. So the majority view in this case laid down a triple test to see whether a particular undertaking is an industry or not. So the three components of this test were that the undertaking has a systematic activity, that this systematic activity is organized by cooperation between an employer and employee, and that this systematic activity is for production and distribution of goods and services that are aimed towards satisfying human wants and wishes, meaning that they are aimed at things that are not spiritual or religious, but inclusive of material things. So if these above three tests are satisfied, an enterprise can prima facie be considered an industry. So there is no need for a profit motive. Please understand, the absence of profit motive is irrelevant. The true test is in the nature of the activity, with special emphasis on employee-employer relations. Now, as per this definition, a big change, which used to be a bone of contention earlier across many states, is that IT/ITES companies are now industry under the meaning of IR code, meaning that all the provisions of the IR code, barring those pertaining to factories, etc., will be applicable to IT/ITES company. Can we move on? Just to add on, earlier what used to happen is that state governments used to, several state governments had extended provisions of these acts to IT companies, that is, for example, Tamil Nadu. But now this will be applicable on a national level, so you do not need to worry about a state government notification. So coming to our dispute resolution bodies, right? There are there's a four-tiered level. Now this is replacing all the labor courts, civil courts, all of this that we had now. All the multiple bodies that had jurisdiction over labor matters are done away with. There are two bipartite forums. So the bipartite fora are your works committee and your grievance redressal committee. The works committee is must be established in all establishments having 100 or more employees. And the objective of having a works committee is to promote good relations between employee and employer. Now, a grievance redressal committee has to be established in all establishments employing 20 or more workers. Now, a worker may apply to the grievance redressal committee with their dispute, and the same must be resolved within 30 days of receipt. If it is not, the worker can approach a conciliation officer, which is the second level, or voluntary arbitration, which I will come to. So the conciliation officers are going to be appointed by an appropriate government, and the conciliation officer must resolve the industrial dispute within 45 days, pending which, if the parties do not reach an agreement, the parties are given 90 days to approach the industrial tribunal. Now, voluntary arbitration, just to quickly bring a point in, is essentially allowing parties to have arbitration clauses and refer industrial disputes to arbitration as well. This is a practice that is ongoing. It has only been given statutory basis now. Now, the industrial tribunal and the national industrial tribunal are the two major bodies. So industrial tribunals will be established across states in India. And there is already a provision within the Industrial Relations Code which talks about transfer of cases. So all pending cases, once these industrial tribunals are established in the respective jurisdictions, the cases will be transferred on a jurisdiction basis, meaning that from the labor court that has jurisdiction in a particular area, it will be transferred to the industrial tribunal that has jurisdiction in that particular area. Now, the National Industrial Tribunal will only hear the most important matters and will act as a sort of dispute resolution body to deal with the most important disputes in the country. Moving on. So the standing orders. So standing orders under the IR code essentially apply to all establishments that employ 300 or more workers. Now the scheme of tripartite consultation, meaning employer, employee and union, is retained as it was under the Industrial Dispute Standing Orders Act. Certification of model standing orders is required, and the scheme remains the same. Earlier, even state governments had the power to issue model standing orders, but that has been done away with. There will be standing orders only on a national level. So for all of you that are working for pan-India establishment, this is a welcome change. You will not have to comply on a state level. On a national level, you can comply. Now, point number four is very similar. Again, your model standing orders need to be submitted to a certifying officer who is appointed by the appropriate government. Also, something to keep in mind here is that the government is contemplating coming out with industry specific standing orders, meaning that if, let's say, you are in manufacturing or you are engaged in IT/ITES, you might have to comply with a set of model standing orders that are industry specific. So please keep that in mind as well. And just to wrap up the last few points from this, the provisions relating to strikes and lockouts is very similar as it was under the ID Act. The 5A, 5B, that scheme has been retained in the same manner under the IR code. And the only thing to note under strikes is that the notice period provisions have been made more stringent, meaning that you have to provide notice before you go to strike. Otherwise, that strike would be deemed illegal. Moving on. This would bring us to the end of our presentation. So over to you, Gulshan.
Thanks all. Honestly, as I mentioned, this is a very short time to cover all the four codes, and the agenda here was to only give a high level briefing and reading of the context. But we would like to move on to the Q&A. We have already quite a few questions published, and apologies that we have timed this shortly. But I will pick some of the very critical ones, which are again have commonly asked in many of the sessions where we have attended. Most importantly, what I generally see in the terms of the reduced transactional compliance is what is the key takeaway, especially terms like inspector come facilitator. We don't know what kind of changes this is going to bring to overall how compliance is being managed and what how the department will reciprocate to that. In terms of how gig workers are going to get impacted, all of these areas, including Contract Labor Act being a major reform is going to happen in the licensing piece, coming as a very, very huge respite for a lot of employers. But revolving all of those, I think the most basic question, which I think a couple of them have already asked, is on the by when and how this will go live. Uday, if you want to take this up quickly on by when tentative this will go live and how this is going to happen.
Yeah, Rishabh. So we have been interacting through various forums and federations like ISF and CA and all, and we are also been part of giving certain recommendations and suggestions for drafting the codes and giving suggestions. And as per our last information, all these codes together may become effective by 1st of April is the information from the Labor Ministry.
Okay, thanks. Anime, we have a few, as I mentioned earlier also, we have quite a few specific questions for on the code of images. That was what I anticipated, but I will quickly pick on some of those which I also feel quite relevant. One very early was posted by Bala. I think Bala is from ThoughtWorks. Will special allowance come under the 50% category? Also, variable is paid once in a quarter based on the target achievement. Will variable component be considered for wage calculations since it will be varying with performances?
Okay, so to answer both those questions quickly, because we're short on time.
First, is anime audible to Anuk and Uday?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Right, so the allowance firstly, right? Yes, it would come under the excluded allowances because commission-based payments and performance-based bonuses, as of now, prima facie, from what we have studied and understood from the courts, would come under your excluded allowances. This is because if we rely on the jurisprudence of the Supreme Court up till now, the Supreme Court in Surya Roshni and both and the Vivekananda judgment has looked at allowances and said that any allowance which is not paid universally, normally, and ordinarily will be excluded from the scope of basic wages. Only those that are paid in accordance with those rules will be part of basic wages. And this is something that I believe will be followed in the courts as well, because the definition that has been employed is very, very similar to that under the EPFO Act. However, there might be some clarification from the government later on this matter. But as of now, it is safe to conclude that yes, they would be part of the excluded allowances and so would performance-based bonuses. Over to you, Vishal.
Thanks, Anime. I think that answers completely. We have one immediate question from Satin Talreja from Thomas Cook. And this was one of my earliest questions where I debated this. Anime, I would want you to take this up. As per Code of Wages, what is retaining allowance? I remember me, Uday, had a long, lengthy debate on this.
So Anime, as of my discussion with multiple people, including Mr. Udaya and Madhu sir, what we have come to understand as retaining allowance is simply any emolument paid to keep an employee employed, rather retain him in his employment. Beyond that, the term has not been defined under the courts. You would have to wait for further clarification by probably the courts or the tribunals, because there is no definition of the term. So on a prima facie level, all we could say is any emolument paid to keep a employee within their employment. That's it.
That answers. Anime, one more under the of wages. This is one comes from Mr. Amlan Das from Linde. Will annual performance bonus be considered as excluded remuneration? Anime, you want to take it?
So this would come back to the first question that I dealt with, right? Annual performance bonus would come under a commission. That is commission under your clauses A to K. If I'm not wrong, it would be clause I, but I would have to go back and check. of the excluded allowances. Now, why I would say that annual performance bonus will not be considered is again coming back to the logic in Vivekananda and in Surya Roshni, because annual performance bonuses are not paid universally, normally and ordinarily. They are paid on the basis of certain extra work that is done above and beyond normal work, which is why on a prima facie level, it would be apt to say that for now you can consider performance-based bonuses as part of the exclusion. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. Back to you, Rishabh.
Thank you. Let's move to some couple of questions on the Social Security Code. This comes from Bhavan, I think. Bhavan from Cantor Operations. What is PF applicable on? Is it similar to gratuity, which is on wage as salary as defined? What will be PF applicable on? Is it the same as a gratuity where the wage is defined?
Well, in the present scheme of things, the PF and the gratuity, the definitions are completely different. The industry practice with respect to gratuity is to take the last drawn basic and DA as reflecting in the salary slip in terms of to calculate and disperse the gratuity. With PF, as my predecessor speaker was referring to some case laws with respect to the Surya Roshni judgment and the Vivekananda judgment, where the jurisprudence on what is basic wages has been clearly defined by the Supreme Court. While under the code, what would happen over here is the fact that there's a common definition for PF as well as for gratuity, because they both being under the same code, that is the Social Security Code. So for gratuity, I think there was a specific slide on that, where there would be an impact. What we see towards the cost of gratuity would be going up, or the liability would be going up for the employers, for the reason that the industry practice now is to exclude all allowances in terms of calculating the gratuity, only rely upon the basic and DA. But that would not be the case with the present wage definition, because if there are excluded allowances beyond 50% of the total remuneration, they would be added back to the wages. Point number one. Secondly, if on the retirement month, if an employee has been provided some kind of incentives or some settlement in his wages, whether that would be added back to the wages is a question. So that is why in the rules, what we have suggested is in the Social Security rules is that to average this wage of say past 6 months or 1 year, so that there is some, there's some justice even on for the employer when he is calculating the gratuity. But for purpose of gratuity and PF under the Social Security Code, the wage definition remains the same. Hope that answers.
Fair. And there's one more under the same sector. Once employee resigned, how many working days does the employer need to pay their final settlement? I think there's no change in that as far as I'm aware, but you can add more light to this. Once employee resigned, in how many days does the employer need to pay their final settlement?
Okay, so I think this query comes under the code on wages, but I will take it up. In the present scheme of things is where an employee is terminated, where there is that is when the severance of employment is involuntary, that is where you need to settle the wages within 2 working days. But if you read the code on wages, it says that even in a resignation case, you need to settle within 2 working days. I think this would pose an operational challenge for payroll companies as well as the employer, for the fact that in a resignation case, whether they have to settle within 2 working days. So I think as soon as the employee tenders his resignation and serving the notice period, I think it would be wise enough for the employers to inform their HR and to get their calculations ready so that they would comply within this timeline. While I think the government can still have a chance of extending this timeline in terms of resignation cases, in terms of F&F settlement under the rules, but since it is prescribed within the Act, so I doubt whether rules can trespass the Act itself. So I think employers, once the code on wages is implemented, as soon as any resignation cases, please get ready your F&F calculation in hand so that you can comply with the timeline provided, which is within 2 working days.
I think that was clear. to all the audience, we have already spilled over the scheduled time of 5 hours stop, but my sincere request, we stick for another 5 minutes. We will take few more questions. As I told you earlier, we will have a Q&A or an FAQ document shared, which will comprise the majority of all of these common questions which have been asked. And we plan to host few more sessions in concurrent with this, so that all of your questions are addressed to the best possible way. So just stay tuned for another few minutes. We'll take a couple of more questions. Uday, I think this, I would want you to take this up. I think one of, it's anonymous, but one of, I think this gentleman belongs to some logistic, one of our clients. He says there are two questions actually. Is the annual health checkup will be applicable for logistics companies? Uday, can you hear me?
Please unmute.
Rishabh, we lost you. Can you just please come again? I think you.
Yeah. So this comes from I think a gentleman from the logistics sector. He is asking whether the annual health checkup is applicable for logistic firms.
So it is applicable for certain notified establishments. Logistics have not been notified, but 45 and above is one which has been made for 45 and above age employees. All the employees have been requested to be made. So that is one which has come in the draft rules. That may get changed by state to state again when the state rules are framed. So yeah, it may be made applicable or may not, depending upon the state of presence of the person. But in draft rules, it has been made for 45.
One fundamental question which always comes up, Uday, first come up, and we need to give this clarity right away. It was in the OSH code, whether all the establishments will fall under this, or is there any applicability threshold for the OSH code?
OSH code applies for
population we today service.
Yeah, except for establishments which are not in hazardous process or under dock workers or other aspects, it applies only for establishments which has 10 or more workers.
10 or more workers, okay.
Yeah.
And process also recommends a certain registration, right? Can you throw some light on that? That's one of the most important aspects, because as again I mentioned, the audience here, many of us come from the establishment sectors where we have a commercial establishment or an office, and any new registration will again be an additional compliance. While we are aware of the shops and establishment license we already have in place, that's again a state act, but specific to OSH code, will there be a registration specifically?
Yeah, this will have a registration per se, but again, it will have one registration concept. One contractor may have multiple presence and take one registration. This actually will reduce the compliance hurdles for an employer who is majorly in a contract business or a staffing business. With respect to principal employers, again, it is a very lesser this thing. So compliance perspective. So I don't think it has enhanced the compliance hurdle or compliance requirements more. Rather, it has reduced the compliance requirements from employer's side. But registration is there. Yes, it is a requirement.
Okay, so we had to get the rules out and how this registration will happen and all.
Rules have come out, Rishabh, but how it is going to get implemented, whether it, how the windows are going to work with the central department, whether it is going to be integrated with the Shram Suvidha, whether how it is going to get with the state level, that and all is yet to be looked upon.
Okay. In the benefit of time, I have a short 15. One last question, and I think this is one of the interesting questions which I have picked up from my one session. Uday, I want you to take this up. on the IR code, and specifically I picked this question because in the last few months we have some of our companies clients have gone through this situation. If we retrench workers under IR code, apart from the retrenchment compensation, is there any other liability to be paid? Anything specifically highlighted in the new code?
No, I don't. So the S2L code also had a requirement where we used to have a notice period also to be paid. So that notice period is still there. So notice period and retrenchment compensation, then your other leave encashments or additional benefits and all are there, which is part of your terminal benefits. Under IR code is your retrenchment compensation and your notice period.
Okay. I think we have still quite a few. I see the excitement of so many questions still pouring in. I have recorded all of those gentlemen, and rest be assured that our team will quickly coordinate all of this and send you or circulate the FAQ document, and we'll try and host it as well for ease of retrieval. Thank you all. I think it was very fast. I understand, but please stay tuned for further communication from ALSEC and Simpliance teams. We will have a few more of these sessions very shortly so that we can imbibe more of these codes and actually really decode them. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Uday, Anuk, Anime, and our key coordinator, who is at the back end.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, team.
Thanks, everybody.